Thanks for the introduction. So I'm here to present the interim work progress of the research entitled Behavioral Response of Autistic Children to Design Interventions. So at this juncture, I'd like to acknowledge the support given by ANFA in the form of a research grant. So to start with the presentation, the structure of the presentation. The presentation is structured in this manner. Like first, we'll be dealing with the background studies that led to the research design. And then research phase one, which we completed. Like we started the research in January 1st, 2016. So it's like 6 months work forms a research, 8 months work forms a research phase one. And then details of research phase two, which we'll be doing, and prospects of future research. So the background studies, I said, from the medical side, it was observed that autism is a developmental disorder, and most of the children, most of the autistic children have atypical sensory perception. So mostly they have visual problems. They'll be either hypovisual or hypervisual. So like most of the 90%, more than 90% of the autistic children have atypical sensory dysfunction. And from the architecture side, it was observed that changes in the environment, we all know that it changes the brain and it has the capability to influence our behavior. And we looked at the design approaches for architecture for autism. And there are two types of approaches, the neurotypical design approach and the sensory design approach. So the neurotypical means you are designing for real life settings, and sensory design approach means you are designing for a sensorily comfortable space for the autistic child. And when I looked at each of these cases, it was observed that there is a possibility by reducing the sensory overload, possibly we can bring about some behavioral response in autistic children. Like what if we can help in the management of autistic children? So we sat together and we focused on studies with autism and studies with home-based interventions and studies with post-intervention tracking of response. And finally, we found that there was a research gap several studies with focusing on educational institutions, educational learning environments for autistic child, all these home-based interventions was missing. So that in order to fill that research gap, we formulated the hypothesis, like can prolonged exposure to design interventions altering visual perception induce behavioral changes in autistic children? And the proposed methodology was that initially we'll be doing the secondary data collection, the literature review, interview of specialists in the field, case studies, and based on all this information, we'll be formulating some design guidelines, some broad design guidelines, and based on the design metrics that we are formulating, we'll be doing a primary study of user responses. Like pre-intervention assessment will be done. Then, after providing the spaces, designed spaces at the homes of 30 autistic children, we'll be doing a post-intervention assessment after a period, and then analysis will be done. So the timeline and the phasing was that from January to August, the research phase one was done. So we culminated in the finalization of the design parameters after the case studies, and till that, we'll be presenting now. So in research phase two, we'll be having the initial assessments, the exposure to the design interventions, and the final assessments. So that is yet to be done. So the literature review, again, is structured into two parts. That is autism and associated visual perceptual differences from the made easy for an architect to understand, and designing for autism made easy for a neuroscientist to understand. So the architecture side and the medical side. And in the medical part, first, we'll deal with the normal visual perception, then the autism and the associated sensory symptoms, and the theories explaining these sensory symptoms, and what are the sensory subquadrants in autism, and what are the visual processing differences in autistic children. So like atypical visual, normal visual perception, if you deal with normal visual perception, it's best explained by the mass theory. And I'll just briefly tell that according to mass theory, when you look at an object, there are three stages in which that you perceive, that internal percept is established. And the first stage is primal sketch, where you get to have an idea about the fundamental elements or the edges. And in the second stage, you add on certain aspects to the already gathered information. So the element, the facts that you add are figure ground discrimination, the ability to distinguish between the foreground and the background. Then depth perception and pattern recognition. So all these you add on to the edges. And in the 3D sketch. In the final stage, in the 3D sketch, you have an object-centered representation. So till now, it was a viewer-centered representation. So now you have an object-centered representation. Even if you are changing your viewpoint, you will still feel it as a constant object or not a changing object. So that is known as object constancy. And coming to the autism symptoms, though clinically we say triad of impairments for the clinical identification of autism, impairment of social interaction, social communication, and social imagination, we are more bothered with the sensory symptoms. So like there are also non-triad features like obsessive desire for sameness, that is insistent on the same setting, then savant abilities some people have singing abilities. So we are more interested in the visual sensory symptoms, and the visual sensory symptoms are hypervisual and hypovisual. There are two categories. Hypovisual means it's easy to understand hypovisual because they'll be like staring at your face, like looking intensely at objects and looking at your face, and attracted to light, has fascination with reflections, so they'll be running hands around the edges of objects. So all these are cases of hypervisual. And then you have hypervisual cases. In hypervisual phases, they'll be just the opposite of hypervisual. They'll be looking down most of the time. They'll be avoiding eye contact. And they'll be like covering eyes if they have bright light falling on their face. And they don't like bright colors and bright light. So we looked at the theories, the cognitive theories and the neural theories, which could possibly explain the sensory symptoms. And I'll skip through the cognitive theories because we are more into one of the theories I'd like to say is the neural theory, the neural connectivity abnormalities, because like this is one neural theory that could very well explain the sensory aspects. That is, abnormal neural connectivity is one reason for the motor, cognitive and the social difficulties in autism. And there are other theories as well. And coming to the sensory subtypes in autism, like if you normally look at a person, there will be like, if you normally take a normal person itself, you will have a neurological threshold and a behavioral threshold. So a neurological threshold is a point in which there is enough input to cause a nerve cell to activate. And a behavioral part means the person has an active or a passive strategy for responding. So when these two continue or intersect, you have four patterns. So low registration, sensation seeking, sensory sensitivity, and sensation avoiding. And according to Winnie Dunn, children with autism have more intense response in one of these patterns. So like if you have a more intense response in low registration, those children will be having more, they'll be missing more of the sensory cues than other things, other children, and they'll be failing to notice things, and they're more easygoing. So low registration and sensation seeking forms the hypovisual, and sensation avoiding and sensory sensitivity forms the hypervisual, if you are overlapping the studies by Winnie Dunn and Bogdashna. The final part was the focusing on the visual processing differences in autistic children, and that was lesser susceptibility to visual illusions, because you might find that most of the autistic children tumble over things and fall down, so they don't have a understanding about the real relative distance between two objects. And then failure of shape constancy, like if you look at an object from at an angle also, you'll see that it's still a circle instead of an oval, so that shape constancy is missing. So there will be so much of visual overload for the children. And gestalt perception, as I told you, there is an ability to distinguish between the foreground and the background. So that ability is missing. And deficit in visual form processing, the simplest form. If you're looking at an object, you'll have difficulty in extracting the simplest form. The autistic child will have difficulty in extracting the simplest form. So coming to the designing part, designing for autism, first we looked at the influence of altering visual properties of built environment, then designing for behavioral impact in children, then design approaches for autism, and modifiable elements of design. What could we possibly modify in our case? So the visual properties, the vast literature could be actually summarized into five heads: the visual properties for arousal, visual properties for security, attention restoration, negative emotional states like anxiety, pain, fear, and positive emotional states like healing. So for arousal, the suggestion is that visual complexity, there are studies which suggest that visual complexity can actually induce arousal in the user. Then security, there is a prospect refugee theory which says that there a capacity to observe prospect without being seen, refugee, that induces a feeling of security. Then attention restoration, that is restoration of the directed attention or a stress restoration. And the restoration of the directed attention, for that Kaplan and Kaplan formulated the four aspects, that a space should have enough amount of fascination, then it should have a feeling of being away from the rest of the spaces, then some extent or some boundary by which you can actually define it, and compatibility between one's own functions and one's own intentions and the actual functions that are taking place in the space. Then visual properties for negative emotional states, so the things that we have to avoid, so like unpleasant violence, then ambiguity in the design, lack of familiarity, then low spatial frequency, the first figure shows low spatial frequency and the second figure shows high spatial frequency, then sharp contours. So all these are actually causing negative emotional states. Then positive emotional states for stress reduction, restorative environments, one of the studies is nature views. So nature views induce healing. And another study is that fractal patterns and fractal geometry could be satisfying to the human mind. So like such kinds of self-similar symmetry could be useful. And for again, designing for behavioral impact on children was studied, and how the children bond to the environment was studied, and a general technical design features which have been found which are found to be related to positive child outcomes was elicited. So like good acoustics, good indoor climate control, good lighting, non-slippery floor surfaces, soft wall surfaces, and warm colors. And coming to the design approach for autism, as I told you, there are two approaches, neurotypical design approach and sensory design approach. And we are focusing on the sensory design approach. And in sensory design theory, which has been put forward by Magda Mustafa, she has developed an autism design index and actually an autism design metrics and guidelines. But the guidelines are actually generalized, and there is also a case study has been done. And we can understand that though the guidelines are actually, they can be used, but they can be used only in the planning of educational spaces, and a more specific guideline needs to be formulated in our case, since we are designing for a home, we are giving home-based intervention, so we have a very small intimate space within which the design elements can be modified. So then we looked at the modifiable elements of design. So the modifiable elements of design were listed by Simon and me, so were taken. Then interview of specialists were done, and doctors, developmental pediatricians, and child psychiatrists were interviewed. And for designing spaces also, an architect was interviewed who had published a book on designing educational spaces for autism. And the major inferences are that from the doctor's side, it was inferred like sensory design is not advisable for a very long exposure because the child will insist on the same setting. So we have to reduce the exposure period in order to provide acclimatization to sensitivities. And case-specific desensitization is a core component of the therapy that Dr. Nina Shailan offers. So like both of the doctors advise that if you are providing sensory design, the exposure period must be very less. Then for designing for autistic child, there also Rajana Kari was telling like comfort zones are good, but it's equally important to prepare them for real life settings beyond the comfort zone. Otherwise, the child will insist on the same setting. So again, case studies were done, and after formulation of a case study format, some pilot studies were done, and then observation study of the child and questionnaire survey of the caregiver was done at the homes, and several case studies were done. And the inferences from the case studies are, the management techniques used are actually directly related to the sensory differences. The caretaker doesn't know that the child responds to a very high music because the child is hypoauditory, but they actually use it without knowing that. And in the older kids, most of the sensitivities have been overcome. Like they have overcome their oral olfactory sensitivities, etc. So most kids have insistence on sameness. So the possibility of the child insisting on the same setting upon prolonged exposure cannot be ignored. And most of the kids have auditory, olfactory, and tactile issues as well. So we cannot actually thoroughly ignore the other aspects and focus on visual interventions. So based on this, some guidelines were formulated. So general design guidelines for psychologically comfortable space was first formulated. So like for adequate arousal, visually complexity is needed, and how to convert that into architecture was considered. And again, general design guidelines for early childhood was formulated. And after this, general design guidelines for sensorily comfortable spaces in autism was formulated. So low registration and sensation seeking added on becomes a hypovisual. And for visual processing difference, more specifically, design guidelines for visual processing difference in autism was formulated. Like if you have a gestalt perception, then you can actually make the edges more prominent. And if you have lesser susceptibility to visual illusions, you can avoid drastic variations in sizes of objects adjacent to each other, and you can avoid hurdles in the pathway. So based on overlapping all these guidelines, we formulated a matrix, and the modifiable elements, the 9 modifiable elements of design were listed, and visual, auditory, tactile, and olfactory cases were considered, like senses were considered, and in each of the cases, hypo, normal, and hyper was considered, and a matrix was formulated. So each aspect will correspond to a number, and in some cases, hypo and normal will be having the same number, and in some other cases, normal and hyper will be having the same case. So based on this, the guidelines were formulated, and the details of each, for each number, there will be a detailed design guideline. So this is more specific and can be actually implemented on site based on the sensory difference of the child. And then in details of phase two, in phase two, we'll be doing pre-intervention assessment, like CAS will be done for a severity of autism. Sensory profile 2 will be done for the assessment of the sensory difference in autism. Then the parenting stress index short form will be done for measuring parenting stress, which is an indicator of the, which is the indicator that we are using as a behavioral part. Then exposure of test group for 1 month, and post-intervention assessment and analysis of result. And the prospect of future research is that while we were doing this study, we came across where several other studies like diffusion tensor imaging of the brain of autistic children suggest that, the, as I told you, abnormal neural connectivity is one of the reasons for autism. So like white matter tracts may be atypical in autism with decreased connectivity in the parieto-occipital regions, which are actually involved in the sensory integration region, sensory perception and integration. And if sensory problems are actually one of the reasons for this cognition, social cognition impairments in autism, by correcting that, there is a possibility by which language can be improved and the cognition can be improved in autistic child. So like the opportunity to receive appropriate input, if we are giving the opportunity to receive appropriate input, brain has the ability to process and integrate sensory input. So like so that possibility has to be explored, and there are instead of designing for neurology, designing for sensory comfort, actually shouldn't we be designing for sensory discomfort? So the looking at that aspect, we found that longitudinal studies proving that symptom severity in autism decreases with age. So that could actually be possibly due to slow desensitization over years on exposure to the real world. So in this context, you should have a crossover longitudinal study focusing on, now we know what is comfortable for each case, so you design for discomfort also, sensory discomfort also, like you have a manipulating environment in which you can actually change to sensory discomfort, and within a week or a month exposure to such a setting, it could possibly be institution-based, within such an exposure, what could be the impact on it, on the neurophysiological correlates of sensory integration and symptom severity in autistic children. And to conclude, research phase two will be completed as per the timeline, and prospects of future research focusing on exposure to this design interventions inducing changes in the neurophysiological correlates of sensory integration and symptom severity in autistic children will be explored. Thank you.
Again, any questions? And we can wait till all three presentations have been made. All right, let's hold.